March 24th, 1998, we are interviewing survivor Mr. George Topas. This is tape number 9. You had told us how you arrived and found out you were in Majdanek, and now you were standing around near the square in the camp itself. What happened then?
Well, I was standing in a procession that was going to be moved, marched to another place, obviously. And we had no idea, you know, where we are being taken. We didn't even know exactly where we were at the time. It was only later on that we found out that we were in Majdanek, and this was Plagi Lashkevich. And so, as I mentioned before, the German guard was standing, the young SS man. He asked me how old I was, and I told him that I am 17 or 18 years old, I forget, and he answered, he says, I'm 19, he said to me. And then he said, Schade, dass du musst sterben. It's a pity that you have to die. If there was any doubt in my mind, you know, up till this point as to what is awaiting us, then I realized then, and I remember I began a prayer, which is a... which is one, I think, one of the Psalms of David, very frequently said, and it is called Ashrei Yoshvei Beisecho. That means, fortunate are those that are who sit in thy house, meaning, you know, in the house of the Lord, meaning in the house of prayer, house of study, not realizing how ironical the expression was. And at that time, we were sort of like a group towards the end of the whole procession of the transport, which must have had over 1,000, you know, people, perhaps more. And as we were moving ahead, we seen in a distance that on the side there was like a podium, and there was a high-ranking assessment standing there with an officer that was standing and a couple of officers around him, and one of them, you know, with a whip was standing, you know, in front of him on the ground. And when our group came closer, we said, let's stay in step, let's move in step, let's keep together. And I think that this was said to us by Moshe Kessel. And we did this. And this is what happened. Vishogrod, who was the artist, came to this guy and was asking for mercy to be spared because he's an artist. And their answer that he got was that the guy cracked the whip that rolled around his neck, and he yanked it, made him lick dust. And then he got up and he says to join the group. Then Kessel went out and had a letter in his hand. And he's walking to the podium. And the guy wanted to also strike him. But the man who was in charge, you know, the commanding officer of the camp, as we later found out, he raised his hand and not to strike him. And he gave him the letter, and he picked up the letter, took off his gloves, or if he wore them, and he began to read the letter. And after he read the letter, he gave an order, separate the Okencha group from the rest. And they seen where our front rank was, where the Okencha began, and anyone that was behind us, except the children, was saved, even if there was not part of Okencha. So actually on that day, we were only 88. About 150 people were saved altogether. The rest went to the guest chambers. How did we know all that? When we were separated, there was a scene there that two children got a hold of one of our men by hand, and they said to them, Daddy, 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 in confusion. So he, when the assessment sees this, he says, he told them to go with the group that is going to the guest chambers. So he said, I'm not there, Daddy. So he tore him away from those children and sent him to the Okencha group, and the children went to the guest chambers. When we found out later, and that in a confusion, we lost one man that went to the guest chambers. But of the 88, 87, who survived that moment, and others who were behind us survived. And then they told us to go on the side where the barracks were, and they told us to sit by the barracks. And we were sitting against the wall of the barracks. And they told, and the commanding officer, before he discharged, he says, "You're going to be sent to a good camp, where you're going to be well cared for. If you work, you're going to be well cared for. Everything is going to be, you're going to be doing fine in an aircraft camp," they told us. The letter, later on we found out, Castle had the presence of mind to get from the commanding officer a commendation letter that we are aircraft mechanics. And he presented that letter, and this was the thing that in a realm of the natural, this was the thing that saved us. And they put us up that night in a barrack there in Majdanek. We slept overnight. The next morning we were put on another boxcar train. This time we got rations. And we were taken to another camp, and there were Ukrainian guards on the other end of the line. And we begin a new epoch in being prisoners. Because until now, we were still treated as prisoners, but as human beings. We slept in beds. We were allowed to keep our personal belongings. Like, I had pictures of my family. I wore my own clothing that I came with. It was pretty tattered, but was my own. And we were not yet stripped of every vestige of human dignity. When we arrive in this camp, it started with whips and screams and yells and kicks, and the tension built up. So we were marched to the camp, because the railroad sidings where we were dropped off was not in the camp. And when we came to the camp, we seen barbed wire, and it says SS Waffenkamp Budzin. And this is where it was, a small camp, maybe altogether 2,500 people in this camp. And by German standard, that was a small camp. And we were put there in the what they call the Appellplatz, which is the parade grounds. And we stood against the wall of a building or something, or maybe against the fence. And we were told by the administration of the Jewish administration to wait for the camp commandant, that he will speak to us. And all of a sudden, this guy arrives on a motorcycle, dismounts the motorcycle, and his rank is only a sergeant. And he has a Mauser, you know, that is hanging on a sling from his, and he's got a pistol and a Mauser. And he starts making a speech to us. And he says, "This is a good camp. You're going to work in an aircraft factory. If you work, you'll eat. But anyone that has gold, silver, diamonds, any kind of jewelry, must turn it in." And someone moved in our ranks while he was talking, and he immediately whipped up the pistol and shot him on the spot from our group. And we froze in place from this point on. And then the guys, the lackeys that were working under him, they began to say, come on, let's get the money out and so forth. You don't need any money here. This camp will provide you with everything. So people began to empty their pockets if they had anything. I didn't have any problem because I didn't really have anything. And some people had some things, and they hid it, and they didn't give up. You know, they realize that having valuables is also part of the survival game. Then we were assigned to the barrack, and we found out a whole new regime there, and there was a black eldest there, black Führer, which is called, that means that the eldest of the black is the guy in charge of the barrack. And then we were divided in the morning in the groups to go to work, and everybody was assigned a group that he will be working with. Our group was assigned to agriculture, meaning to the fields, which was the worst that you can imagine, except that maybe they could find some food in the field to supplement their diet. I happened to be in the camp there, and someone from our family, friend of a family named Luxembourg, recognized me, and he pulled me out of the group. and took me with him to a very small group, maybe of 7-8 people, who were setting up another camp barracks for the Polish voluntary workers. And I went with him to work with this group, and I found out immediately that this is a tremendous improvement. When we came in there, we found out that mainly what they do there is when the barrack is finished, they supply it with closets, you know, with chests, with waste baskets, with chairs, tables, beds, you know, mattresses and all sorts for Polish workers that were coming in there, because this camp was built around a Heinkel plant that was a few kilometers away from the camp. Was this aircraft plant. When the Germans had a very ambitious plan that they were building, they're going to build twin-engine bombers in the camp. And they were bringing on the trains equipment and machinery from all over the world that they conquered. So some machinery had nameplates from France, some machinery had the nameplates from Czechoslovakia, from Russia. All of these were brought to this thing to set up, to work, to make, to manufacture planes. And we were on the fringe of that camp. That Polish labor camp was very close to the plant, but our camp, where we were actually barracked, was quite a distance, and we used to go and march every morning to this camp. And the routine was like this, that there would be, on the parade grounds, we would stand in a quadrangle in formations, and there would be count would be take place. Then there was a division of work. In other words, people went to various groups. And then by groups they would be marching, you know, to the place of work. And on the way there we had Ukrainian guards, and they demanded that we sing on the way to work. So we had to sing usually popular folk songs that the army sings and so forth. And this singing, I think it did maybe a little to alleviate the tension that existed. If the Ukrainians didn't have anything to do, they would charge into the ranks, beat people, and if there were some stragglers in the back, they would be merciless with them. So they people had to maintain ranks and stay in a tight formation, and it was always advantageous to be in the front formations rather than in the rear.
What were your barracks like?
The barracks were actually horse stables converted to barracks, and this was also the beginning of the dehumanizing effort. These barracks did not have beds, but it had like shelves that were going continuously and had mattresses laying on them, and it was a double decker. In other words, there's an upper and a lower perch. I slept on the upper decker when I was there, and I was working in this group for a while, and then I met the commandant of that Polish camp. His name was Garbe, and he was sort of a friendly kind of a guy outwardly, and he engaged me in conversation when he see me for the first time. So he asked me, he said, "Was ist dein Name? You know, what is your name?" So I said, "Georg." He says, "Was bist du von Beruf? What is your occupation?" So I say, "Ich bin ein Gärtner. I am a gardener." He says, "Good, I have work for you." You know, and he showed me, you know, that he wants me to do work there, to plant flowers, to grass, because there was a lot of, you know, it was like a construction area, so it was all undone, all dug up. So this, I have a new thing. So he says, "Luxembourg, you know, you brought the gardeners." He says, I always try to ingratiate himself to the commandant. So he says, "You see your commandant, how I know how to peg them, you know, that sort of thing." In German. And he was a shrewdy. He was an old shrewd guy. And I suspected that he thought that maybe I have some money attached to me and that he may somehow benefit from it. But I may be suspicious without due cause. Anyway, this work continued for some time as a gardener. And what we had there in these barracks before the Polish workers really were given use of this area, the Germans established there a training school for officers, for Air Force officers. And they arrived and occupied all the barracks, and we'd seen them marching in the morning and singing. and doing a lot of things that they, you know, they were washing there on the outside. They had outside bassinets and they were washing there and doing all the things. And after a while, they arrived a a civilian assistant leader whose name I call Schleswig. I really don't remember his real name, and I should. And he began to talk to me in Polish. And he told me that he's a German from Rostock and that he knows Polish because this was once a disputed area, you know, of Poland, or maybe he lived in Polish part. And he tried to befriend me and speak to me, and one time he asked me to walk with him home by myself. So I say, how could this be? I have to march with a group. He says, I will arrange for you to have permission to walk with me. And I did walk with him one time to the barracks, to this settlement where the German civilians and the Croatians, they were collaborating with the Germans and working there.
How did you feel sleeping, walking with him?
But I tell you what, I am jumping the gun because there's one thing that happened with Fikes that preceded in chronology this event. What happened was this, that someone escaped from the camp and he got caught. His name is Jack Eisner. He wrote a book himself, The Survivor, and he became quite wealthy after the war. And they caught him and they brought him back to the camp and they brought him to Fikes, who immediately decided that he should be hung. But there was no facility for hanging in Budzin. Shooting, yes. And we heard from the old-timers there that he shot a lot of people. There were a lot of people executed. They were whipped to death. There were some things that were just terrifying. So the Ukrainian guards went ahead and they brought a post and they dug, you know, very rapidly. They dug something in the ground. And they took the post and they built, you know, like an L shape, you know, thing. They suspended the rope. They made the loop. They suspended the rope. They told him to stand on a chair. And they put him in a loop of the chair and they pulled out the chair from under him. And he swung for a moment and the whole thing broke down and he fell on the ground and he was alive. So they tried this at least twice and didn't happen. Then they abandoned the idea of hanging him. But he got a whipping like no one else ever got in a camp before. He got 50 lashes, and after 50 lashes, and he still was breathing, and he was still could speak, so he ordered that he should give him another 25, that's 75 lashes he received. When he was finished, next day, they put him to work next day, carrying bricks in the camp. Eventually, he was put back in a group, and the whole thing was forgotten. And the only thing was forgotten because Fikes thought that he couldn't have survived this beating. And he probably died and he lost interest in him. Because people were dying every day from hunger there. So one more guy, one less guy, what does it mean? Nothing. And there was the first place where the word Muslim, you know, went into the Muslim was a generic name for anyone who began to already show display the features of swollen legs and he is on the way to die. So they were calling, you know, like an intermediate stage between living and dying. So there were a lot of Muslim men there. You couldn't survive on their rations alone.
What did they feed you?
They gave us, I think there was like this, in the morning there was coffee made out of acorns, which was hot, basically it was hot, that's why people drank it. At noontime, they had soup in the camp, and in the evening there was a bread ration that they gave everybody. They would take a large loaf of bread, maybe a 2 or 3 pound loaf, and cut it in 16 pieces, equal pieces, and that's what you had, a 16th, or if it was a smaller loaf, an eighth of a loaf of bread. It was like you could make out of this 2 slices of bread, and that's all. And sometimes with this there was jam. Sometimes something else that they gave you with is something that was extraordinarily. This rationing was made for people to die, not to live. So the question is, why do they give us food at all? Because they want to use up, you know, the work material that they had, the human machinery. But if we died, there was until now inexhaustible supply of manpower from Russia. But the Germans began to, you know, retreat from Russia. This was already 1943. And they couldn't be, so easily people couldn't be replaced. Actually, later on, the rationing did improve slightly because they had no replacement for people they killed. So they had to slow down the killing process. But the killing process continued to the end of the war. It's just that they decided that before they killed them, let's use them up.
Now, you were saying you were taking a walk with this Mr. Selig. How did you feel walking with him along without a group or without?
That was a strange feeling. That was for a moment kind of it was a heady feeling of being in a country because the country was beautiful. And anybody that would come to our camp would think it's a summer camp on a first impression until he came to the barracks or he seen one of the executions that took place almost weekly, that something had to happen. And usually on Sunday, because we were in a camp. So we dreaded being in a camp. Being at work was safer, because there, the main point was to work. In the camp, was different.
How did you spend your time with Mr. Selig in his house?
Mr. Schleswig.
Schleswig.
We walked to the settlement. He brought me to his apartment, and he told me something about his family. He complained about the war, apologized for the fact that they elected Hitler. They said that at that time when there was unemployment, that there was the depression, that Hitler offered bread and opportunity and work and order, all of these things which were lacking in Germany. He says, but now it's obvious, he told me, that we were betrayed and that Germany is being destroyed and that people are being, you know, keeping in a state of terror. Even us Germans, he said, even some of us have to be very careful. So I listened to all this. I nodded, but I didn't say a word because I still were not 100% sure, although liked him, that he is on the level.
Did he feed you anything while you were there?
He gave me probably something to eat, but I don't remember. The thing that I do remember, he offered me eggnog, and it was food, but when I began to drink it, I realized it was spiked, and I had a few drinks. Then he walked me back to the gate, you know, towards the evening, he walked me to the gate, and I was allowed in. And the commanding officer, who was no longer Fikes, because Fikes was replaced by a fellow named Tauscher, who had the rank of a lieutenant. He was a Sturmführer. And Tauscher, with his corpulent body, looked at me and he said, "You are drunk." So I said, "No, nine Sturmführer, ich bin müde, I am tired." So he called a Jewish doctor to come out. It was a German Jewish doctor. And he says, "Is he drunk or sober?" So he walked over to me and sniffed me like a dog. And he says, "Er ist bestimmt besoffen." He's certainly drunk. So he called out the guards and so forth, and they put me over, and I got whipping for it. I got whipped by him. At the end of the whipping, he didn't dismiss me to let me go to the barrack. I was put in the guardhouse, in the basement of the guardhouse. It was like a coal bin there, and I was laying there and to lick my wounds, because every time that the whip, you know, dug into flesh, at the end was a lead ball, and that dug in flesh. To this day, I have scars where it sunk into. So I was bleeding a little. But I was put in this bed, and they wanted to know where you got liquor. They found out where I was working, and they went over to Garbe, to my employer, you know, this guy who was in charge. And I think I was also brought to work there in his presence. They asked, and they asked me, did you give him any liquor? They asked Garbe, they didn't ask Schleswig. So he said, you know, he said, definitely not. So he says, well, he got liquor. So Garbe, to prove, you know, his loyalty and so forth, began to beat me about the face, you know, vigorously, you know, slapping me about the face. And I didn't say anything. And I never said that Schleswig gave me any liquor. And they somehow left me. And not long after that, I left Garbe, you know, and I got reassigned to a job in the plant. And I was working as an inspector in the plant, in the aircraft plant itself.
Were you ever sick in the camp?
Yeah, I was once sick in the camp. So I was taken to a hospital, which was a little barrack, you know, about 500 feet from the main camp compound. And there was a couple of Jewish nurses there, and they had a Jewish doctor. And there was no one there sick besides me. So they were glad to see me. And I was put in a nice, clean bed. For the first time in my life, I seen white linens, you know, since my internment. And they gave me tea. They made tea for me, and I felt like I was in heaven. But when they gave me aspirin and pills, I don't know what they were. I didn't take them because I was afraid to do anything like that. And I also realized it's no good. So after being a day there, I told them that I'm okay and I don't feel bad, and then they sent me back to work. And I was working as an inspector of parts. And I was also working later in a place called Pauserei. This is a place where copy making is made of aircraft parts and stuff. It was actually an office job, which is very remarkable. It didn't require any physical effort. But it was in that time that I began to suffer hunger pangs, and I didn't have anything or anyone to help me. So one day I was sitting at the barracks. It must have been already in fall of 1943, probably early November. One thing happened. Yeah, that was also in November, so that falls in sequence. I was sitting at the barrack, and I was thinking of a way, how can I, you know, possibly secure more food for myself? And suddenly, you know, I was thinking of all kinds of ideas to break into the kitchen, you know, warehouse, to break into the bakery. But all these things just did not seem like they were viable options. But I knew one thing, that they had a magazine, that means a little storage place for clothing, used and otherwise, that were given to prisoners who were brought to camp and they were in rags, so that once in a while they would bring a company and change their clothing, you know, give them new rags, as they called it. And I said, if I could get new clothing and still retain what I'm wearing, I could sell some things. They are sellable items, especially a sweater or pants, things like that. So I made a decision that one day I'm going to hide what I'm wearing in the morning, and I'll just come in my underpants and say that everything was stolen, everything was lost. And I was hoping that the camp commandant, I mean the Jewish camp leader, would send me to the magazine to be outfitted again, and I will be able to have something to trade, to live on. So I decided that this has to be done. And one morning, I did exactly this, and everybody's running out wearing already overcoats, and I'm coming half-stripped, you know, wearing just underpants. So the Stockman, who was the commandant there, says, where do you think you are going? So I said, to formation. So the others, the underling, they were standing with him, they said, they were laughing. And I had a feeling also that they seen through me what I was up to. But he was a very gentlemanlike guy. And he said, listen, get him dressed. Take him to the magazine, get him dressed. He says, if Tausche sees him like this, he is going to whip him to death. So they reluctantly take me to the magazine. And there, where the guy was looking for one item. I was putting three sweaters on. You know, I was doing whatever, you know, whatever I could in the moment of opportunity was open for me. And I secured for myself, you know, a time extension for my survival.
We'll continue this on the next tape. March 24th, 1998. We are interviewing survivor George Topas. This is tape number 10. You were just saying, Mr. Topas, that you were getting clothing at this magazine and
yes,
putting on extras.
Yeah, I did the best I could to take as many pieces of clothes that I could while the fellow was looking for my overcoat to fit me with the right size overcoat and shoes. So to make it short, I was able to have something to trade, and there were Polish workers working in the plant, and I would give a guy a pair of pants and he would supply me with bread for a couple of weeks, that sort of thing. So this gave me a lease on life. Then an event took place very shortly, I think, in November that stands out in Budzin. There were many executions. They had all those makings of the theatrics, you know, that when there were at one time a German Jew, an officer in the Tsar army, was hung, and nobody knew how, why. To this day, we don't know why, but we suspect that a man who had medals, you know, and was a German hero and kept in a camp was apparently an embarrassment to the Third Reich. So they did away with him. And that was this is the first hanging that we have seen in that camp, other than the unsuccessful hanging of Eisner. On this they built a very regular gallows. I remember that he was pleading that he should be shot as a soldier, not hung as a thief, but they would not, they would not hear of it. There were too many things happen. I mean, for all the details, I guess anybody that really wants to know would have to read my book, which probably is not 100% either, but at least it has all those details. The thing that stands out in Budzin, that one time when I came to work, before I switched my jobs from Garbe, from this Polish camp, and the Poles were already in the camp, he gave me instructions to take hot water, pot or pail, and take it to one of the barracks, which he described to me. When I went into this barrack, I was astonished. There were SS men with machine guns, with so much fire weapons. It was unbelievable. They must have been maybe 20 or 30 of them that were cleaning the guns and doing this sort of work. And they were even singing a song. And I remember the song, that the words of the song, "Es geht alles vorüber, es geht alles vorbei," which means everything passes, you know, everything is, you know, goes, it sort of is, becomes forgotten. An appropriate song for what they did and got away with it. And I remembered I brought this water, and I stood up, and I must have been stirring. So one of the Germans noticed this. He says, "Was schaust du an?" He says, "What are you staring at?" So he says, "Mach raus, you know, get out." So I left. Next morning, our camp was closed, and we didn't go to work. So I began to realize that they're going to exterminate the camp, that this is an extermination commando that has came here. And at the same time, the loudspeakers announced that they want registrations for inventors, chemists, engineers, people with scientific knowledge. So I said to myself, in this situation, everything has to be tried. So I went to the office and registered myself. So they said, well, what is your occupation? So I said, I'm a chemist. So they wrote down chemist and my name next to it. Then another day passes by. I think probably on the third day they opened the camp and everything returned to what was before. And we never knew why the extermination commander arrived and why they left. And the speculation was that the German civilians and the director of the Heinkel plant, that they argued with the Germans and they told them that this is essential to the war effort and therefore it has to be spared because it's vital. And when before I published my book, I took the book, the Extermination of European Jewry or Destruction of European Jewry by the professor in Vermont, I think, Burlington University of Vermont. And I seen their footnotes, but he said that there were some documents. This plant was spared at a time where after the Sobibor and Treblinka uprisings, Himmler ordered all the camps liquidated in the area. And they were liquidating camps left and right. And Budzin was on the list.
Where is Budzin located?
Budzin is located not too far from Lublin. But it was in a Lublin district, and the Lublin was the Majdanek was the head camp for all the sub-camps, such as Budzin. So this is the reason that we decided. But I was at a reunion of Flossenbürg survivors, who were also, some of them were from Budzin, and they told me an amazing story what spared that camp and how high in the hierarchy of German echelon of power this had to go to countermand the order that was given to liquidate this camp, but that would take several tapes in itself. So I'm going to have to skip it now. What happened is this, that we were in the camp, and in the late, in midwinter, the Germans decided to take this camp and change it into a concentration camp. It was considered at that time had the statute or the category of a SS work camp and was going to become an SS concentration camp. And in order to become a concentration camp, some other rules applied. So what they did, that the Polish camp that existed on the fringe of the plant was converted into the concentration camp. And we were transferring there, given the striped uniforms, you know, with the striped caps. We were shaven, you know, with a center aisle, you know, in our hair to make us easily identifiable. And a new epoch began in our experience as prisoners. We went one rank lower in this dehumanization process, because we were laughing at one another when they first got those funny haircuts, and we began this period.
What was the name of this camp?
It's the same camp. It just was moved closer to the plant, and then the job began. There was one job assigned to to dismember the existing camp, you know, to disassemble it. To wreck, some barracks were wrecked, some were disassembled, and I was assigned to this job. In the, at one time, I went to the old laundry where people used to be change clothes and so forth. And I was looking, and I found a 200 zloty bill. And I immediately put under the rim of my striped cap. But I was noticed by the German who was in charge of the, who happened to inspect on that day, usually he was not there. He seen me doing something that didn't look to him right, fishy. And he told me to come to him. But I ran out from the other entrance and I began to run. But once I mixed with the other prisoners, we are indistinguishable one from another. Everybody is wearing the same suit, the same uniform. But then I heard the click of the revolver, and then I stopped. And he walked over to me. I didn't move. I froze in place. And he took off my cap. He took off his gloves. He groped under the rim of the cap and found a 200 zloty bill. And I thought I was going to be beaten to death or he's going to shoot me, but he didn't do it. He put the 200 bill in a sleeve. You know, the Germans have turned up sleeves of their coat. He put it in there, and he wanted to write on something, but he didn't have any paper to write on. So he took his cigarette case, and he marked, you know, my number, because we're given numbers. He marked my number, and he says, "You're going to experience something."
Not tattooed. These numbers were not tattooed, were they?
They were on a uniform. So we came to the camp, and the whole thing was forgotten. Every day I was worrying when they're going to call my name out for punishment, because the Germans don't forget such things, and they are very. But then it dawned on me that maybe he will not report me, because if he reports me, he has to turn over the 200 zloty to the authorities. But if he keeps it, then nothing happened. And he's 200 zloty richer. His name was Kleist. That was his last name. I remember it because I had a meeting with him again. One time when we were coming back from work to the new camp that we were in, that was already in March, there was a frisking. They were for contraband. And what they did, since this was never done before, they laid out blankets in the middle of the yard, of the parade grounds, and they put in a couple of mess gears for money, and they said, any other things, food, to be just put on the blankets. So all you have to do is just go by this place, empty your pockets, and join the group that was already frisked. And the Germans were standing not far from the blankets, so they were checking the people that emptied the pockets to make sure that they don't have any, so they would feel them around, you know, whether they didn't have anything. And this process was taking almost all day. You know, all day we came from work, so it wasn't too much of a day was left. And suddenly it got dark. And the groups that were far apart, of those that were frisked and those that were not yet, was drawing together, and it became kind of a confusion. And all of a sudden it dawned on me that there is some money there that I should not let the Germans benefit from, but I could benefit from it. So I used to wear this overcoat. I slipped in there, you know, in the confusion, and I took through the pocket of the overcoat and picked up one of those mess gear and hidden under the overcoat and walked over to an outhouse in a camp. And in the camp, I had a pin. I took the pin and I took all the big bills and I stuck them from under the board, you know, upward to stay there. And I also had a cigarette case that I found among the things that were there. And then I waited for the dismissal, you know, of the group to go to the barracks. But it's quiet, and I don't hear nothing, and I hear speeches. And all of a sudden, I hear the word, Topas! Topas! Then all the men are yelling, Topas! What has happened is they found out the disappearance of the mess gear, and they wanted to know who it is, and they threatened that they're going to keep people here until the culprit is found, that they will be standing in attention. It was still March, it was cold, the men had to go to work. Then people gave my name, and the name spread like a wildfire, and I became a celebrity all in the camp. And then I realized that my time is up, that this is the end. So I said, the hell, I'm not going to take that money out. But I had some small bills on me in pocket. And I walked out and came. And who's standing there with a whip in the front of the whole quadrangle of men assembled, standing in formation? Kleist again. So like meeting you again. So I feel like he says, you always have something to do with the money. So when he said to me like this, he took the whip in a loop, put the loop under my chin, you know, of the whip, of the horse whip, and he said, how did you come to this money? Because when I walked in, I emptied my pockets of the small bill, I put it back to the mess gear, I put the mess gear back, and I stopped there. So he says, how did you come to the money? So I really make one of those stupid acts, you know. You know, I am a very conscientious worker, and to me the most important thing is to work. So I said, look, I am a very conscientious worker, and I am working on this Barakenbau, meaning, you know, the building, which is actually this assembly. I would like very much to work well, but I don't have any strengths with the food that I'm only receiving here. So I said to myself, I put the money, then I say I better take back the money so I can buy some bread, you know, and I could eat this bread. Then I'm going to be strong enough, I'll be able to work, to produce. So this guy looked at the guards on the left side, on the right side, he looked at me. And he says, did you ever hear that BS? You know, he says, Quatsch in German, that's hast du gehört, das Quatsch. And then he whipped me right across the face, and he told the guards to give me 25 lashes. So they gave me 25 lashes, and I stood up. That was my mistake. So he says, you can stand, give him another 25 lashes. By that time, I got 50, so I knew already not to stand up. And the guys, some Jews, were standing there nearby, and they tell me that I should, you know, they told me in whisper in Polish that I should, you know, I should not look so strong when I'm finished. So he finished with me, and I was taken to the barracks. And a couple of days later, incidentally, the money that I hid was blown away by the wind inside or something, and it was all lost anyway. So I did it all for practically for nothing, for the sport. But eventually, they one of the administrators, you know, among the prisoners, the Jewish administrators, said to the guards, you know, from this group that was going to work, to ask Kleist, who was in charge, the same guy. He says, "Can I zurück nach Arbeit gehen? Can you go back to work?" So he says, "Yeah, last man does Gauner arbeiten." He says, "Yes, let the racketeer work." He called me Gauner. So the guards that were in our group, I became something of a celebrity to them. They admired me for it. And they befriended me. They called me to a barrack where they were burning fire, and they shared their sandwiches with me. They were practicing shooting for a target, you know, clay things they were shooting there just to occupy themselves. They gave me a rifle to fire a couple of shots. And they told me that I'm doing pretty good shooting. Because I remembered I used to go to one of those amusement parks and learn how to shoot there. You know, this sort of thing. Anyway, I was wondering what happened with my registration for being an inventor or chemist. In late March of 1944, we were called out, the people that registered were called out, and they were put on a boxcar and sent on a train, and there were rumors, we're going to Vienna, we're going to be scientists, all this. We were taken back to Majdanek and kept there for about a month, maybe a few weeks. And there they stripped us, you know, there the pictures of my father was taken away from me. The last vestige of humanity, you know. I was just naked as I came from my mother's womb. And when we finished with our showers there, they gave us completely new wardrobe, you know, prisoner wardrobe, new striped suits. No one, the only thing that they would let a prisoner keep if he has a pair of glasses, they would let him keep the glasses. And from there, we were made into a larger group and were sent to Plaszow of the Schindler fame, Plaszow in near Krakow. And in Plaszow, we did not have a very glorious reception, but we were brought to the camp again by the Ukrainians against the induction. We were standing in a group, and the Jewish camp leaders, there were two of them, one was called Hilevich and the other one was called Finkelstein. And Hilevich's wife was the head woman, you know, of the women camp there, which was also there. And there was a little bit of talking there, and then we were inducted to work in this camp. And of course, this is when I met Mark. I made my friendship with Mark, who was also from Warsaw. And we made a very strong friendship between ourselves. And in the course of time, we had a very mean couple that they assigned to us, a fellow named Foringer that was really decimating our group by beating us viciously. And we were doing work which didn't serve any useful purpose. Like, they had us dig trenches and then cover them up, build new trenches, to dig them deep for no specific reason. And we were beaten there very badly. The people that were caught there, they were sometimes crippled just from the beating. And the eventually, they put me on a job which was leveling a hill right outside the camp. Actually, it was outside the concentration camp, but not outside the perimeter of the entire camp, which also had guard barracks and other facilities. And there I heard about Amon Get, what a vicious commandant he is. I heard about the special hill there where they were doing all the killing. They said that the whole Krakow ghetto, most of the people were annihilated and executed right there. I said that this guy kills people for breakfast and for lunch, just for the sheer pleasure of killing, that he is furious. And I have seen him on occasions when he came to the camp, you know, and stood there reviewing the troops, so to speak. When I was working on the hill, the German copper who was in charge would wander off for the job, you know, and frolic with women, with the German women who were capos there, were SS women. And at one time, he appointed me and my friend Rosenberg, who was with me, as foreman on a project, which turned out to be, first, it was only leveling of the hill. Because he seen one time that I told him not to pitch the rails downwards because it could pick up momentum and kill somebody in the speed. So he felt that I'm putting my thinking I'm thinking about the work. So he made me and this other guy foreman, appointed me foreman, without asking whether we want to be or not. And once this was in effect, we realized that once the hill was level, they wanted to build an SS hospital. And they felt that being in a close proximity of the camp, it would be safe from bombing, from Allied bombings, from Russian bombing. I reluctantly, you know, undertaken the job of being a foreman on this project, but I had very little choice to do it. And one time, when the people in our group were very rarely really working very hard, you know, only when the Germans were around. So we had usually a stakeout. If anybody approached, they would say, you know, Sex was the name, you know, like Zex, or sounds like Sex, but there was a code word, you know, that someone is approaching and we have to look busy and give kind of an impression of a beehive activity. So one time they came on the hill, the Hauptsturmführer Blanke from the Auschwitz fame, a doctor from Auschwitz fame, and he was with a, he was assisted by a sergeant, and it's a rear door of the Auschwitz fame, and they came up and they looked at the, what was going in there. They were not satisfied with the work. Who is the foreman here? So the people pointed to me, and he said, "Like sich nieder, lay down," and I lay down, and a guy took something like a 2x4 and began to beat me with it for a considerable amount of time. And he said to me, and the guy that was beating me, "Say to the Hauptsturmführer, you tell him that that the work will be done. Es wird gearbeitet, work will be done." And my Jewish friends, you know, they were in a group. They asked me to do the same thing because I was losing my, consciousness. You know, I felt that I may blank out. So I said, "As Herr Obersturmführer or Herr Hauptsturmführer." Excuse me, he was Hauptmann, but he was Hauptsturmführer in SS rank. "Es wird gearbeitet," you know, that means work will be done. So he led off on me, and they found out there was another foreman, and Rosenberg, and then they beat him very viciously and cruelly. And I was helped to my barracks by my friends, and Mark came in, and I had compresses. I was really in bad shape. But there were no bones broken. And quite frankly, I think the next day I went back to work. But I knew that my days are numbered if I will remain foreman on this project for very long. And yet I didn't see any opportunity to leave this project.
How were you fed at that time? What were you given to eat?
Pretty much the same in the other camps. The only difference here was that maybe there was a bigger quantity of soup that they gave in here than they gave in other camps. And maybe the ration of bread was better, but people were dying in this camp just like they died in other camps. And Mark and I had to think, you know, of ideas what to do. And I knew that I had to break out of this job. One time I was for an undisclosed offense, I was sentenced to be in a Stehbunker, in a stand-up bunker, where people, when they stay there for 72 hours motionless without food or water, they usually don't survive. But when I was standing in bunker the first night, came one of the sergeant, and he looked in the hall, you know, through the window and seen me. He says, "What are you doing here, foreman?" So I said, "I was put in here. I have no idea what I was put for." So he let me out, and I was turned loose free, and I went back to work. But I realized that I couldn't continue with this, and I asked of the Jewish administration to send me to another job. And they did send me to another job, and the other job was a outpost when they were dismantling railroad rails, which was a very back-breaking, hard job to work. There were about 200 men on this group, but the opportunity on this job was smuggling, because did not have the SS to escort us. We had the gendarmerie, which was another military formation. And we were able to bribe them. In fact, I was instrumental in it. We bribed those guards to allow us to sell things to the Gentiles in one of those inns, and to buy, in a return, to buy food and breads from them. And for the guards, we would give them vodka and bacon and bread, whatever they like, so that we would get for them. And they agreed to this. And they were taking us themselves on the guard. I would go with a couple of other people to this inn, and we were making transacting business. On the way back, of course, it was our risk to see that they will not frisk us, because sometimes they frisked our group, then we lost all the country. We had to lose everything practically. But they were very clever. They didn't want to discourage the trade because then they had nothing to confiscate. So they did not do it, you know, like day after day, but they did maybe once a week, once in 2 weeks. So the capital was spent, and we had to start from the beginning.
How long were you in this camp?
Very long, quite long. I think we were there from April of 1944 to October 1944. From April to October.
And then were you transferred to another camp?
Then, on one day, they came in and they called out that all the people who registered chemists have to come, you know, and be examined or be questioned about it. And I was standing in line to such a, where there was the investigation, to the place, to the office where they were interviewing those who were registered. And I didn't believe my eyes. The highest ranking officers from several branches of the German armed services were there. And one of them had a pointer, and he had a big blueprint on the table, and he verified my name and my number and so forth. And then he said, look here, pay attention. This is a combustion engine and so forth, and the air comes in here, and here it is heated, there it is cooled, and then it transfers to liquid. He says, after he spent maybe 5 minutes showing me this, he says,
we'll continue
do you think you can work on this project?
We have to continue this on the next tape, okay, Mr. Topas? May 24th, 1998, we are interviewing the survivor, Mr. George Topas. This is tape 11. Mr. Topas, you were telling us that you had been called in because you had registered as a chemist, and there was a high command of Germans with a map spread out in front of them, and they were talking to you about it.
Right. They, of course, questioned everybody who registered for it, and they asked me, the question was, as he put it in German, glauben Sie, dass Sie can arbeiten auf dieses Projekt? That means, do you believe you can work on this project? So I say, ja, aber nicht selbstständig. Yes, but not independently. Because I didn't understand a word before that he explained to me about the drawing. I had not the vaguest idea of what it was all about, even if I tried. So we were registered with this formality dispense. I was told to leave, and they marked something there. And that was the end of this, and nothing immediately happened thereafter. But probably two things that stand out in Plaszów that happened there was a selection by Hauptsturmführer Blanke, which occurred in late spring or early summer of 1944, where we had to strip naked and take our clothing, bundle it up. I know my friend Mark had a very prominent scar on his body where he was operating an appendix, and so he took the bundle and covered it up, you know, as he was running. And then people were motioned to left and right and so forth, and people who were eliminated from the, who were eliminated were sent to Auschwitz and that for liquidation. We passed that selection test. The next thing that happened is that there was a transport to Mauthausen from Plaszow. And they rounded up the whole camp, and anybody that was not considered essential to whatever work was done in Plaszow. And I didn't know for certain whether the fact that I was registered as a chemist, whether it would protect me from shipment to Mauthausen, which was a very tough camp. Mauthausen was a camp that had a very bad reputation, you know, among camps, everything being relative. So Mark and I decided that we would hide during the roundup, you know, for this camp. And of course, what they did, the boxcars came into the Plaszow camp, and they were standing on the railroad siding right inside the camp. And in the morning, they said that everybody should fall out, and they're going to make the selection now who's going to go to the camp, who's going to remain. We wanted to remain in the camp. So Mark and I and another big fellow named Chaim, I think, decided that we will hide in the barracks and we'll take a chance and we will not come out for the selection. And what we did, we found one barrack which was on the edge of the parade grounds, you know, where you could see what everything else happened, and there was like an opening in the to go into the attic. A little like a hatch opening. So we climb into this opening, and there were a lot of mattresses and stuff. Then we closed the door of the opening and piled up the mattresses on top of it and laid there for a while. Then the guards and the kapos went through the camp, and they were searching for people who did exactly what we did. And they came up towards the attic. And they were yelling, "Hey, you there, come down," you know, as though they knew that we were there. And this guy that was with us, this big fellow, Chaim, he was frightened and he was ready to give himself up. And Mark literally held him at his throat not to make a peep. And somehow he remained quiet and we remained silent. And they went away and we were left there. Later on, we watched through an open little carved out hole in the wall of the barrack. We were watching what was going on the Appellplatz, and we seen how people were gathered and being shipped. And I remember an incident when a nurse cut her veins, a Jewish nurse from the local hospital. She cut her veins and committed suicide right there. Then there were a couple of people who were found hiding like we did, and they were shot right there on the Appellplatz. And then there was such a heat, we fell asleep. When we woke up, it was still going on. But then we have seen hoses were turned on the train, on the boxcars, and the roofs of the boxcars were hosed down with water, with powerful streams of water. And we were wondering who ordered this, because the Germans were not interested in our survival, and the heat was oppressive. It was very hot. And if someone is in a boxcar, then the heat is trapped under the roof of car, and it's intolerable. We have learned later that Schindler bribed or persuaded Amon Goethe to, just as the film, Spielberg film shows, persuaded to have those wagons hosed with water. So that made, as they made, so Mark had a brother on this transport that went to Mauthausen, and he survived. He went through Mauthausen, went to other camps, and he survived. And perhaps in some measure, in this water helped survive that moment. And in October, they called again, when it was all forgotten, you know, all but forgotten about this whole scientist project. They again called us up and told us that tomorrow we're going to be leaving we're going to be transferred. And we got on a train again. There was a boxcar for us, but they gave us food on a train and so forth. And we had a couple of guards with us. And we were sent to Flossenbürg.
Which is where?
Which is in Germany, in Bavaria. It's not far from the Czechish border.
And can you spell the name of that?
Flossenbürg is spelled F-L-O-S-S-E-N-B-U-R-G. U umlaut with the two dots, RG. That was a bleak camp, high up in the on a height maybe of 3,000 feet above sea level, like a mountain. And there was a Messerschmitt plant, which was the main Messerschmitt aircraft plant where people were working there. And there were other things. When we came in, we were put to work on the road. So I didn't understand what kind of a scientific project this is. But that didn't last long. Eventually, we were assigned to to what they call a lab and to work on a project. And then we still didn't know what was this all about that we are working on. And then a truck came and dumped a lot of books in a bag, and the books had hardly any relation with whatever we were supposed to working on. One of these things was Myers Encyclopedia, and another, and there was a book I remember that I found out on various diseases control. And this was principally what was found among the books. But the great prize that was there waiting for me, I didn't yet find right on arrival. But that was a very nice thing, because we were going here into the winter. The cold was very bitter there, almost always snowing, windy because we were on top of a hill. And we had to march every morning formation with all the workers that were coming in the groups. And we came there for working in this office or for being productive. We were getting a second breakfast. In other words, besides coffee, we got a slice of bread at about 10 o'clock in the morning. we wanted to know what to do. So that we set up tables there. There were like four picnic tables. And each table supposedly had another group of scientists. So in one table were draftsmen. They were construction, the construction. On another table, they were biologists, dealing with biology. Later on, we found out that they dealt with biology, what effect this weapon would have on the environment. Then there was another group that was called chemists, which I supposed to belong to. But I still didn't know what I was supposed to do, and I certainly was not chemiker, so I felt the fear that I might have overreached myself here, and I may, for bluffing like this, and if the Germans found out I was bluffing, that would be my last day in the camp. And there was another camp. There were dolmetschers, translators. What would translators do? They translated Russian chemistry into German, which the Germans were raising their eyebrows. He said, German chemistry is inferior to Russian chemistry? After all, this is where the Germans shine, is chemistry and science. But that's what we were doing. And the group was about 62 men, you know, and they were people that I knew already from Budzin and from Plashov. They were in this group. And there were some other people that were picked up. We were mostly Jewish, and we were called Jewish scientists. And there were a few people, there were some Poles, there was a Hungarian, and there was one Czech fellow who also played bass violin in the orchestra of Flossenbürg camp. Flossenbürg had an orchestra that played on Sunday there, gave a concert in the bathhouse. And this was one of the cultural events that they permitted to play. But they didn't allow to play any German composers. You have to play anything you want, because it was beneath dignity of these composers and the German culture that these miserable prisoners should play their music.
What were your barracks like in Flossenbürg?
The same, the horse stable type barrack, with cuts and so forth. But my whole life and my pleasure was, such as you can derive in a camp, being in this office. After we got to this, the camp was a miserable place. The workplace was tolerable, and we were in a place that was heated, and this was winter, and people were working outside and freezing. It was terrible, and we were getting this extra meal. Then one time I'm bored with this all, and I'm browsing through various books, and all of a sudden a book fell on the floor from the shelf. I picked it up. Lo and behold, David Copperfield. For elementary school children, or, you know, another children edition. And then I did some much browsing, found a grammar book, a basic grammar book. So I decided at that moment that I'm going to study English, that that's what I'm going to be doing. And I began learning words. So the reading and learning English from, I knew some basic English. We once had a tutor that my father hired for us. And I had some basics in it, very, very small vocabulary, perhaps less than 100 words. But I started David Copperfield, and if I knew, let's say, sentence has 6 words, and I knew 3, I had to guess what the other 3 should be to make this thing, you know, logical. And this is the way it went. Go. The more words I learned, the more I was able to fill in as before, and I was very much pleased with this discovery, because it took my mind off the food, and finally my sense of hunger got a rival, my thirst for learning English. I felt that if I ever survive, English would be a valuable language to know, since my grandmother already was in the States, and I would probably go and join her there. And I was busy with it. Everything was going fine. And one day they sent a guy with a... Occasionally we were visited. I hid the books. And we were visited by a German stormtrooper who didn't understand what was going on. And just so that I would look busy, I made myself a little diagram that was something that I just invented, a drawing that didn't mean anything, but it looked very complex. And also I made some computations, you know, on the, you know, like this equals so, square root of this, and so forth. And I kept it there. So if guards came in, I hid the books, and I looked at these things, and I was busy with a pencil, adding, subtracting, dividing, and so forth, and generally making it look like I'm doing something. And most of the people, the only people that really were doing something constructive were those draftsmen. They were drafting something that apparently knew what it was. And also, the translators of the Russian chemistry were doing something. Other than that, and the biologists were reading various periodicals about biology. You know, whatever that was going to help them. So that's the way it went. But then came a fellow with dark moon glasses, a short, wiry-looking guy. And he was from Kaiser Wilhelm Institute. This was like the MIT of Germany. And he apparently was to inspect what we are doing. So he set up a little table and chair in the middle of the big room there. And for a moment, he just was busy with his own papers, made it look like he was not too interested exactly what we are doing. And then he began to call people by name to come to him, and he was asking them where they were educated, where they graduated, and then assigned an essay to them to do. So I remember one guy, Zilberberg, who was really had something to do with journalism and had nothing to do with science, was asked to write an essay on sulfa and war. You know, because sulfa is a very instrumental in making explosives. So he went and worked on it. And I began to wonder, what am I going to say when they call me? Obviously, if I'm saying chemist, my goose is cooked. You know, I'm finished. And one day, my turn comes out, and he calls me, and he looks at the list of people, and he says, "Yeah, Mr. Topas, Herr Topas, these nine chemists. Yeah." He says, "You are a chemist, yes?" So I said, "Nine." So he looked. He looked like sometimes a bank teller, you know, when he counts the notes, suddenly finds a counterfeit note, you know, and the speed, you know, of his counting comes to a dead end. And he said, so was sind Sie von Beruf? What are you from profession? So I said, I'm metal technician. So he looked at me and he says, metal techniker, das ist ein großes Wort, it's a big word. Was bedeutet das? What does it mean? He said to me. I start to remember that. And then I begin to think what I'm going to say now. You know, this was good until now. And at that moment, a fellow named Thiel, he was from Luxembourg, and he was one of our foremen in this project. He was a prisoner himself. And he was a saint of a man. Everybody liked him, respected him. He was so noble that even the Germans couldn't, you know, abuse him too much. But he was a prisoner. He was a political prisoner. So he walked in, and he explains to him, he's doing all the technical drawings for when we translate the Russian chemistry into German, since he's knowledgeable in technical terms, which we lack. And I said to myself in a moment, if you ask me, what did he do? Show me his work. He would have nothing to show. But the guy was satisfied with the answer, miraculously. And he didn't ask questions, and he didn't ask me to write any essay and just mark something on the margin. And it was over. The next important thing was that one day I am coming back to the barracks and someone seen your friend, Mark Drzewiecki, that was his original name, Drzewiecki, has arrived in a camp and he is in a transfer barrack or something like this. And I ran over to him and we had a reunion that was unbelievable, tearful reunion. And I invited him to come to my barrack and he sit on my berth, you know, where I was sleeping. I shared with him whatever rations we had there, because transients were not getting very much, they were non-productive. And we shared our experiences and he told me about the death march, because he was actually on a train ride, an open train ride, in frost. He said that on a boxcar where he started maybe with 100 or 120, 150 people, two men were left when this train came finally to stop at Flossenbürg. And they were going all over Germany with this train. It was unbelievable. We also thought it was a good omen that we met. And I told him that I will try to use my influence, which was practically nil, because we felt to each other that there was nothing we couldn't do or wouldn't do. And I knew the interpreter in the camp, a Ukrainian named Voloshin. And somehow another prisoner asked me to do something for him, and Mark, for the other prisoner, brought a gold coin that was hidden. And we used that gold coin to see if we can trade something for these two guys, you know. I added Mark to the bargain. And he said that he will try, but he did absolutely nothing. And both this fellow, first, and Mark, second, were shipped to another camp. And I lost contact with him. And Flossenbürg, I studied English. I also found a guy in our group who could speak and who would tell me something about pronunciation. Taught me a little grammar. His name was Goldfarb. And I remember him because he had very exaggerated arches and walked sort of like limping, like, but he was a very fine individual and he helped me with this. So I kept my mind constantly on this. Then before I knew, the winter was over. And I cannot tell you everything that went in Flossenbürg. You know, one time when I did not know, I forgot that I'm in a wrong formation, and there was a miscount that the Germans were counting the second time and they didn't know why there's one group has too many people and one is missing one. I was the missing one who went. And I said, some fool lost his place. Then I said, oh my God, it's me. I suddenly realized I'm not with the right group. And behind the scenes, I ran over, you know, joined the right group. And it was very cold and it was so long, so the Germans didn't look for the culprit, you know, to punish, because everything has to be punished in the camp. The smallest infraction.
How long were you in Flossenbürg?
I was in Flossenbürg from October of 1944 to April 18 or 19th of 1945.
And then what happened to you with that?
Then the death march. First, they ordered the Jews to report on the Appellplatz to their place. And we are skipping a lot, but this is... And then they called in... When they called the Jews, I felt that this is one time when I'm not going to respond to them the way they want me to. And I felt I'm going to hide, because I seen that the end was very near. We could hear artillery shells firing. And then, as a matter of fact, the camp already had the white flags on top, you know, hanging out. And the German contingent garrison left, and they just left people in the guards who were supposed to be transferred to the Red Cross. But after a few days, the guards returned, and the whole thing returned back to to normal. But we no longer went to work because there was chaos. And they executed some Allied flyers in our camp. They brought them in and executed them there. And we seen that we are here and the camp was ruled by chaos in a camp itself. So I decided when they called that the Jews should report in the morning to formation to be evacuated. I came from the barracks because you couldn't remain in the barrack, and I walked into the hospital ward and pretended I'm an orderly. And I was just walking from one room to another. I found the tray and walked with the tray. You know, I just made myself busy. And in fact, there was one sick guy that was almost on the verge of dying. He hardly had it, but he was yelling, Jude, Jude, a Jew, a Jew. In other words, reporting me. But he was so weak that I just covered him with a pillow. And he couldn't hear a sound anymore from him. So I stayed there. When, even when they came to come hospital, they just ignored me. And after this, the Jews were taken out of the camp. Incidentally, they also survived. But there were many casualties because the Jews were put on a train that mistakenly was machine gunned by Allied flyers. And there were many casualties and wounded. And the rest was marched again. But at the end, they were also overrun by American formation, and they were liberated. And they had some input in overwhelming the guards before this happened, you know, shortly before Americans came. Now, on April 18th, the Germans ordered general evacuation of the whole camp. And I did a little bit of calculation with my limited cycle, you know, sense. And I decided that the last group should be in a better position to be liberated than the first group would be, or second. And they were taking the columns in 2,000 men increments on the road. And then the guards, you know, covered them and they began to marching them. We didn't know where. But later on we found out that the destination was Dachau and extermination there. But because they didn't have facility in Flossenbürg for mass extermination. And maybe the Americans were too close, you know, for them to do some major, you know, shooting in the woods. It was just not suitable for the operation. So there was here we had the wisps of springs, the birds begin to sing, the flowers are awakening from winter, from the winter cold. And there is a kind of a heightened sensation of hope that perhaps, you know, we are close to being liberated. And the question is, what's going to happen first? The Germans usually refer to their end as 12 o'clock. But they always used to remind us that 5 to 12, they're going to do away with us. So we were marching through this countryside and inhaling the fresh air of the woods that we were surrounded us. And this was our group left afternoon. And by the evening, we heard the first shots because the men became tired. And anybody that fell couldn't pick himself up. By the time the three rear guards came, then they simply shot them and threw them into the ditches on the side of the road. And this shooting as the night went became more frequent. And then we stopped someplace in a clearing on the side of the road. Then we marched another day. The second day, I think we got some kind of rations, which were molasses. And also during the march, I met a guy who was a barber in Radom. His name was Mendelssohn. And he seen me in the group. He recognized me as a friend from Plaszow. And he gave me some molasses, you know, because barbers used to get tips and he had some food. So that was a lifesaver. It was a very, very, very wonderful thing of him to do that. And all I'm going to tell you is that the rain began to drizzle on the third day, and we were marching in drizzle. At one time, our formation came to a point where there were retreating Germans going in opposite direction than our group went. And they demanded the right of way from the assessment to move our prisoners, you know, like they say, the heap of garbage, they called us, move it off the road because they have to pass, you know, with their with a unit. So an argument broke out there. And finally, the military threatened the SS that if they're not going to move us off the road, they're going to drive right through us, you know, with their vehicles. Behind their vehicles, there were British prisoners of war. And they were marching behind this group. And we kind of, you know, looked at each other. And they looked much better than we were. And then we came, I think, in the third night of the march, we came to a wood clearing on a hill. And I was helping by the time already on the road. There was a fellow whose name appears in the book. I don't remember it without looking. I think it was Grudniewicz. And he was a Polish journalist. He was not a Jew. And I was helping him, you know, because he was limping. And in fact, the Germans warned me that if he says, if you're not going to let him go, you yourself are going to suffer. But I ignore this because it was not unique that someone was helping someone else. And then I went to break branches because if you lay down on the grass, it was so wet that you would be miserable. So what I did, I felt if we have branches, it will keep us above the wet soil. And the German guard heard me cracking those branches, and he walked and gave me a, first of all, I got a kick in the rear. And then he says, are you trying to make fire? It's forbidden. So I said, no, I'm just trying to make bedding to lay down on. So he ordered me away, not to do anymore. I had a few branches, I walked over there. I think that was the last punishment that I got from the Germans, among many, because I couldn't tell you in the course of this interview what happened. And we woke up in the morning, and every morning they woke up, there were some people that couldn't get up anymore. So they were brought it into clearing, and they usually shut them, you know, before we left the place. And here the same thing. There were some people that couldn't get up, and some people that just wouldn't get up, that they just had enough. It was just, everybody was on a verge of total, you know, despair, exhaustion, whatever, everything mixed together.
How many people were left at this point?
In the group?
From the 2,000?
I think we were probably half of the original group. And this was not the end, because when we came to another, because prior to us, a group that passed us by, and also in our group, on the other end of the group, they just arbitrarily executed 160 people. This is on record.
We'll continue this on the next tape. May 24th, 1998. We are interviewing survivor George Topas. This is tape number 12. Mr. Topas, you were saying that 160 of each death march were arbitrarily chosen to be executed?
I don't know if they were chosen. They might have been a group that they were at random, you know, shut up. And I have somehow eluded, you know, and this group. And this is something on the report of the Third Army Headquarters that took account of this, and there were witnesses. In fact, one of the witnesses, when I was doing research at the National Archives in Maryland, not in Washington, D.C., there were military archives, and I seen their report when someone witnessed that George Topas and someone else escaped this group. you know, of a shooting. Anyway, in the morning, it was still drizzling, lightly, but it looked like it was going, like the rain was tapering off and was very, very mild. And we were making formation as we did every day of the march, you know, to continue with the march. And then all of a sudden, we heard an airplane engine, you know. It was like a single engine plane. And in a few moments, there came what looked like with a white star plane. There was single engine and it was no more than maybe 2,000 feet above us. And we felt so elated and so bold that the guards jumped into the side ditches and told us to stand on attention. We took our caps and tossed them into the air. You know, this was kind of a spontaneous reaction because we felt that this might be that the Americans are close, you know, if their observation plane, we presume to be an observation plane, it was directly over us. But the plane turned around and disappeared. And it got quiet again. And again, they told them, you know, the Germans were saying, Anschließen, that means lock the formation, et cetera, et cetera. And there were two guys there that were ready to, they were cocking the balls to shoot the guys there in a clearing on the side of the road. So it was quiet for a moment, and it was a silence, like a momentary silence, like everybody was looking around, like something is happening, we are not aware of it. And suddenly we realized there was a tremor in like there was an earthquake, a tremor in the earth. It began to shake, and it got louder and louder, and all of a sudden, what seemed to us the horizon, but it was no more than maybe a mile or two distant, tanks appeared, you know, from a lower elevation, came in and appeared, you know, like they're coming up the hill, and on a broad expanse in a field, and there was a white star on the tanks. And someone yelled, Italians, so somebody says, idiot, Italians are out of war. So somebody yelled, American, and everybody yelled, American, American. It was such an excitement to seize the camp. Because moments before, we used to say, Americans, where are you? And here suddenly the tanks came in. When the guards seen this, they dropped their weapons, some of them, and they began to run in all directions. And the Russians who were among us, some of the Russians, they were just unbelievable. They were emaciated. Some of them began to run after the guards. It was incredible, but I was so overwhelmed by the situation that I was not fully conscious of what has just happened in this moment. And the tanks were getting closer and closer, and their rumbling was loud. And finally, the lead tank reached the point where our encampment was, and the men began to kiss the tank. And a tanker stood up in the tank, and they began to kiss his hand. And the Americans were throwing, you know, crates of rations. They were breaking up, falling on the ground, and people picked up K rations and stuff, picking up food. But I was dumbfounded. I just stood there, and all of a sudden the rain stopped, and the sun came out, and it was such a beautiful morning. And the Americans, they looked like angels to me. And I think, and they must have seemed like this to everyone in the group. And I remember that I motioned to one of the tankers that passed by to stop. And when he stopped, I noticed just before the tanks came in, that there was a German infantry unit on bicycles. They had Panzerfaust. They had anti-tank weapons. And that they moved to clearing of the woods, which was not very far away from where we are. And he said, thank you. And he gave one in the cockpit. And then I seen the turrets turn into the woods, and they began to fire into the woods. And later we heard explosions, like ammunition exploding from it. And so I said a prayer. I still was wearing a wet blanket on me that I picked up from a dead corpse during the death march. I threw it away. I took some of the rations. I dared not to eat anything. until I drink something. And that was the day of liberation. You would be surprised to hear the next day, this unit passed by. This was the 11th Armored Division. Later on, during a book signing ceremony, one of the men who was there, and who we didn't know each other personally, but who was there on that day, came in to get one of my books.
What day was this?
That was either April 22nd or 23rd. In fact, I have the map of the division that I show you later, that the march, the line of march, their map shows that they crossed on that day, that road where we were being led. Anyway, the next day, I was in a town of Neuenburg, and I came to the commanding officer of a 104th Infantry Regiment, which I didn't know actually what was the designation, but I know the Americans in there. In fact, I didn't come to him. I was more or less, you know, brought to him with another Polish fellow who was a camper because they seen us with weapons and what might look like we're shooting at the Germans. And it was kind of a pandemonium going on there. And he brought me to the commanding officer, and I gave them their name, and I spoke English because I learned from David Copperfield. And although my English was, you might say, was hardly, you know, good, but it was manageable, you know, for the purpose. And I was brought to the commanding officer, who was, I believe he was a lieutenant colonel or a major of this unit, of this battalion, whatever. And he asked me who I am, and I told him who I am and what my name is. And I said, I have a grandmother living in America. So he said, oh, yes, where does she live? And I, of course, I had no idea where she lived in America. So I said, New York. And she did live in New York, but I didn't have the exact address. So where in New York does she live? So I said, on Fifth Avenue. So, because this is in the movies, they always mention Fifth Avenue. And he was a funny guy. He was shining his brown shoes, you know, as he was questioning me and looking at me in an amusing kind of way. So he says, Fifth Avenue? So he says, on Fifth Avenue. He began to sing a song. He said, it's funny. So he says, well, George, what would you like to do now that you are free? So I said, I would like to get a rifle and a uniform and to go with you fellows and see you still have a part in this war. So he says, after what you went through, and I must have looked like I might have weighed at the time maybe 110 pounds. So he said, wouldn't you rather just take it easy and go in back of the lines? So I said, there's nothing I'd rather do. So he says, Sergeant so-and-so, see if we can find for George to outfit him. So in a matter of minutes, they found for me uniform, a helmet, a tanker jacket, a hand grenade, a smoke grenade, an M1 rifle, two belts of ammunition. And I remember sitting on the truck and they were teaching me general orders. And I became, you might say, if not the mascot, you know, the friend of the regiment.
Now, who was the general of this particular armored division?
I don't know who was the divisional commander, but this was the part of the 3rd Army, Patton's Army. And I served with them. Although I was not inducted legally into the Army, I was with them in all the engagements. I served in the interpreter. I stood guard. And I enjoyed every moment of it. It took my attention away, you know, that I didn't have to reflect what I lost and the fact that I have nothing back to go to in Poland or Warsaw. And perhaps I had to face the fact that I lost everybody. Incidentally, Martin Gilbert, the famous historian, in his book, The Day the War Ended, he has about a page and a half about me personally in his book. So I enjoyed what I was doing. I was very excited. I thought that I am playing a very important part. The fact that I studied English served me well, and I was learning more every day. And at one point, I think that's probably the point, you know, that I reached the zenith of my career as a soldier at that time during the remaining days of the war, because the war didn't last more than 2 weeks after I joined them. A German panzer division surrendered, and they set up microphones, you know, for the division, and a very high-ranking American officer arrived, and I was put next to him as an interpreter, and he was telling me something in English, and I was translating it in German and giving the orders to officers and men, you know, what the conditions of surrender are. And I enjoyed that very much, that I was able to tell. And then I was reminded what my father said in Lublin at the very beginning of the war, when the Germans marched in, and they marched with such pride. Here I seen an officer sitting, you know, with his feet in the helmet, soaking his feet. I have seen these guys, you know, that look disheveled, and their uniforms dirty and torn, and they look like a miserable lot of people. All that starch and esprit de corps went out of them. And I remember that my father's prediction was true. But I think one of the things that I enjoyed that I was translating was this. He would say something to me to the effect, tell the officers that they are responsible for the enlisted men of turning in all their weapons. So I said that, I translated into German, but I added something of my own. I say, if anybody fails to turn in their weapon, wird standrechtlich erschossen. He'll be lawfully shot. And this was a typical German order, that everything that you do with the latest reflection, you'll be rightfully, lawfully shot. So I said that it didn't make any impression on them in the ranks, because they expected that someone would perhaps them, you know, stiffening that sentence might have saved American lives, you know, that people were, that they were more careful about this. So this was the day, and after this, very shortly after this, I served there with this unit until that unit was ordered. This was a 26th Division, Yankee Division. They were ordered back to the States because they had enough points. And I went and offered my services to another unit where I was assigned to CIC. By Colonel Norris, who later became Brigadier General, and he was Secretary of the General Staff, and they gave me a very fine commendation letter for my service with the unit, which appears in the appendix of my book. Now,
where did you live after you parted as a volunteer? Where did you go to live then?
Well, I was with the Army and with the CIC unit to the day that I left Germany. I was with them. I had a very wonderful reunion with Mark, when Mark brought me up to date on his experiences, on his death march. And after that, my grandmother sent me affidavits from, you know, I also was reunited with my Uncle Ben. That's another story in itself. And my Aunt Rose, who still lives in California, Los Angeles. And on early June, I was taken to the consul office in Frankfurt, to the American consul. In a matter of minutes, all my papers were processed. And the next day, I was already in embarkation point, Bremerhaven, to go to United States.
How old were you at that time?
It was already June. I was not yet 21, 45. In November, I was 20 years old, you might say. And I arrived in the United States at the later part of June on a ship named Marine Flesher. And my grandmother and my aunt were awaiting me at the docks in the West Side in New York.
So you never went back to Warsaw at the end of the war, right then?
I went back to verify some of the things. In 89, Mark and I and our wives and two of their children went with us on a trip to Poland, and we had two limos, and we traveled all over to revisit some of the sites. I seen the villa that belonged to us, it's still there. But the building that we lived in Warsaw, ghetto in Warsaw, that is gone and replaced, and some other buildings are built in its place.
What did you do when you came to this country?
What I did in the country, I re-enlisted and became real soldier. And I served the United States Army. I achieved rank of sergeant. I was discharged and used GI Bill of Rights to go to school in Pennsylvania, in Philadelphia, where I got my degree in electrical technology, not engineering. And I became a contractor, and then I became a general contractor, and I was doing some large-scale projects for the United States military.
How did you meet your wife?
Here in Lakewood. We were in one of the Jewish youth clubs, and I seen her at the club. And actually, I seen her first time in a synagogue, and I couldn't talk to her there. But then I seen her in the club, and I approached her, and we made acquaintance, and one thing led to the other, and it was a very short courtship, like from October to February, and on February 12, 1950, we were married in Brooklyn, and she's a Brooklynite, very lovely lady, and we've been married now for nearly 48 years.
And how long was this after you came to this country? How long were you in the country before you met your wife?
Well, that would be about a little less than 46 to 49, about 3 years.
So you were like 24 years old?
I was 25 when we married.
And you have children?
Oh, yes.
How many?
We have 5 children.
All boys, girls, boys?
Beg pardon?
Boys and girls?
4 boys and 1 girl.
Could you name them for us, please?
Well, the eldest is Abraham Henry, named after my father. And he is he's an executive in a real estate firm in Canada, in Quebec, in Montreal, a very large firm. And he's married and has 3 children. And my second boy is Matthew Jacob, and he lives in Baltimore, and he has 6 children, and he's a computer analyst. And then I have a son, Mayor, named after my youngest brother, Mayor Shimon, after my both brothers, and he's a teacher, and he lives in Queens. And my youngest son, Ruel, he should be here by the end of this session, I hope. And he is an attorney and a partner here in a law firm in Jackson, next to where I am. And my youngest child, and the only daughter, Miriam, is also married, has a first child. Her husband is a medical student, and she's an executive at American Express.
Would you like to bring in, before you bring your wife in, though, yeah. I'd like to ask you if you have a message for this generation or future generations?
I think I do. I tell you what, if survivor didn't go through all that, and didn't have, you know, just like a survivor of the Titanic, which is now so popular, he should be able to tell them something that went wrong. And perhaps he cannot tell about everything. He would at least know that there were not enough lifeboats on the Titanic because of the arrogance of the people who felt that there is such a thing as an unsinkable ship. I knew that you might ask me this question, and I made some notes so that I can be concise in telling you about it. Our people in Europe have perished because a civilized nation turned into human beasts, and because they didn't heed the warnings that were there. It was not that something happened, that Hitler came to power, you know, today, and the next day Treblinka camp opened and began to exterminate Jews. But there was a progression of evil, the best way to put it, of evil decrees against the Jews, to disenfranchise again from citizenship, they completely, you know, expel them from the human race. They say, you are not part of the human race. You are less than a human race. You have no right to live, they said to us, eventually. But there were many warnings, and they were not taken. There was this ability to give excuses for everything. So that if Hitler might come, already Hitler wrote in Mein Kampf that he is going to liquidate the Jews, that he's going to do away with them. It was not believed. Just like now, Arafat is telling the same thing to the Arab leaders. So he's saying something else to the Western leaders, but he's not believed by many Jews. Everybody is yelling, peace, peace. And that's the way it was on the eve of the World War II. That Czechoslovakia was the classic example of all cowardice that ever took place, of all the expediency that is used when principle is at stake. They wanted to buy their peace cheap, and they felt that Czechoslovakia was worth sacrificing. At the beginning, it was only the West Bank of Czechoslovakia. But people at the time were denying reality. And the reality was not the peace speeches that Hitler made, but the action that he took. He rearmed Germany. He violated and scrapped the Versailles Treaty. He reoccupied the Rhineland. He annexed some areas which were not permitted under the treaty. He annexed Austria and nobody that called the Anschluss. And then he went after Czechoslovakia. And people did not react in a proper way. There were so many warnings. And I tell you that I would be remiss if I didn't say that all the Jewish leaders were misleading the Jewish people because they were not telling them what is in store for them. People could save themselves. I mean, if people in Poland in 1938 were told with certainty that their annihilation is imminent if they are not running away, whatever way they can, however they can. Perhaps some couldn't. But what happened is this, the only leader that seen what was coming and warned the Jews was Zev Jabotinsky. He was the Beitarist and the revisionist leader of Zionist movements. And he was denounced by all other leaders as an extremist, an alarmist, as the Jews today condemn those who say that the peace treaty with Oslo Agreement is a sham and it's a method to dismantle Israel on an installment plan. You give us a little today and a little tomorrow, and then we're gonna decide the fate of Jerusalem when we already have everything we want. So the Jews cannot, in we cannot say in all fairness that we haven't been warned. We have been warned, but there were many excuses made for it. And the denial of reality is the worst sin that we are committing even today. So I'm saying that the people should be more cautious in their judgments. And at all costs, they should support Israel in their determination not to be repartitioned, not to be reduced to size of a pathetic dwarf when it can be overwhelmed by the might of the Arab armies which are now armed to the teeth with missiles and weapons of mass destruction. Who is going to come to the aid of Israel if Israel is attacked? And how long does it take to finish a country of the minuscule size of Israel? People say that Israel, there's a greater Israel. You look on a map of the world and see what a sliver Israel is. You can hardly notice it. So the name of the country, Israel, cannot be put within the borders of Israel. It is put on the Mediterranean Sea, you know, on the side of Israel, because it's so small. All the countries that surround Israel are bigger than Israel. And yet, Israel of any size is not acceptable to the Arabs. And that is obvious. We have to admit the truth. This is wishful thinking. It would be wonderful to have peace with the Arab people. But a true peace will only come when the peace will be made for the sake of peace and not as a ransom for peace. In other words, we are not going to destroy you or we're going to destroy you unless you give us land. And we are getting both. And there were so many conferences by the Arab people from Algiers to Stockholm where they repeated that this is only a phase in the dismantling process of the Jewish state. So we have to be very careful about it. And if there are in Israel people who are not in love with the land enough, that they are willing to surrender it for anything, it attests to the fact that they haven't been properly educated. They don't know the worth of their own land. They do not know what price the Jews paid for this land in a war of independence, in a six-day war, in the war of Yom Kippur, in the Lebanon incursion, and the war of 56 that I didn't mention. All these wars and all the terrorist attacks. Do people give a damn the fact that Arafat has to, PLO has to his claim over 10,000 dead outside of Lebanon? When you add Lebanon, the figure would stagger people. And yet, Mr. Clinton feels that Arafat is a suitable partner to do peace, to do business. This is what Chamberlain said, that he can do business with Hitler. But what happened to Chamberlain? When the bombs were raining on London and he was dying in 1940, he said everything would be fine, but I was deceived. No, Mr. Chamberlain, I would say to him, if I was standing in his desk, you deceived yourself. You were so anxious for the Nobel Peace Prize, you were so hungry for glory, that you thought you're going to buy peace cheaply. You have a great hand, because if Hitler was discredited very early, this whole World War II might have not happened. So this is my words. I'm saying Israel, Chai, Israel forever. And I believe that the Almighty will not allow another Holocaust in the life of our history, of our people, and that will be restored to our land. And regardless of all the detractors and all the haters of the Jews do, and all the cheap politicians, you know, that meddle in Israeli affairs, Israel will survive them all. We survive rising and falling civilizations, and we are still here.
Thank you very much for allowing us to come into your home.
I don't know whether it helped me much.
Today is March 24th, 1998. We are interviewing survivor Mr. George Topas, and this is tape 13. Mr. Topas, who is the lady in the upper right-hand corner, or the one we see on the screen?
This is my grandmother, Ita Sura Topas. I think the picture was taken when she was much younger than at the time when she came to United States. But she was the lady that sent us the food packages and kept us alive.
And who is the gentleman right below her?
That's her son and my uncle, Maurice Topas. He was shot on the Umschlagplatz in a boxcar, he and his wife, when after the Warsaw Ghetto collapsed.
Who is that young lady, please?
This is my mother, and this is a graduation picture probably from gymnasium, which is high school. And she used this in application for admission to Warsaw University, where she studied law.
And who is this gentleman, please?
And this is my grandfather, Isaac Jacob Topas. He was the founder of our of that company that bears the same name.
Mr. Topas, who is the lady on the right?
This is my mother, Eugenia Topas.
And the gentleman on the left?
That's my father, Abraham Henry Topas. These pictures were taken probably just a year or so after they were married.
So that was way before the war?
Yes.
Mr. Topaz, who is the lady standing behind the monuments?
This is again my grandmother, Sura Ita Topaz, standing behind the monument of her mother Yospa, my grandmother, and her sister Sima on her right, and father of her sister Sheva. And this picture was taken in 1934, and I came to visit the cemetery and found this monument in rather bad condition in 1989, which was almost 60 years later.
Thank you. Mr. Topaz, who are these people?
Yes, this is Maurice Goldfarb, Mieta Goldfarb in Polish, and his wife Stella, and her mother, I think Sheva. She is the sister of my grandmother, the person on the bottom of the photograph.
He was a
prominent attorney in Warsaw.
Do you know when this picture was taken?
This picture was an early picture. It might have been taken in early 30s.
Thank you. Mr. Topas, could you please tell us who these people are, starting with the little boy sitting in the man's lap?
The little boy, that's me. And I'm sitting on my father's lap. Behind my father stands my aunt Bella, which is his wife. And behind, farther in the background, is my uncle Morris. To the right, in forefront, was my uncle Ben, the youngest brother of my father. And next to him is my grandmother, Grandma Suraita Topas, her husband Isaac Jacob, their son-in-law, Krakowiak, married to Bella across the table. And someone in the background might be a brother of this fellow sitting in a very, very back. The way he's positioned sitting, I think that he had at the time already a camera that was automatic, and he set it up and probably ran behind and sat in that position so he also would come into the picture. And a person standing on the side against the post of the porch is my father's cousin, one of the orphans that were brought up in my grandparents' home, and his name is Sevek or Zacharia Topas. He just died last September at the age of 90.
Thank you. Mr. Topas, who are those two soldiers?
One of them is myself, and the other person is one of the fellows in the unit of the 104th Infantry Regiment. And this was a picture taken during the war, at the moment that we had opportunity to take such a picture.
Which one are you?
I am the skinny guy with those very, very bony arms.
Were you in the army at that point with them?
I was not officially in the army, but I fought with them, I served with them, and I got many commendation letters afterwards.
Thank you. Mr. Topaz, who is this young soldier?
That's me. And this was taken when I was attached to the CIC Counterintelligence Unit. and I served with him during the occupation time in Germany in 1946.
Were you officially in the army at that time?
No, I was not officially in the army at the time.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Mr. Topas, what is this parade here and where was it taken?
This was a parade taken at the end of basic training in Fort Dix, New Jersey in the summer of 1947. Or in the spring of 1947.
You had enlisted in the army?
I have enlisted in the army, so I can have this legitimize, you know, my earlier service, which was as a volunteer. This time I was paid for my service.
And where are you?
I am in the front rank with the person in the right there saluting.
Thank you. Mr. Topas, who is the lady standing with you?
This is my wife, Bella.
Where did you meet?
We met here at Lakewood.
And how long have you been married?
48 years.
Thank you. Mr. Topas, who are those people standing behind you and your wife, starting on the left?
This is my son, youngest son, Ruel. And next to him is my son, Meir Shimon. In front of him is his wife, Bunny. And next is my daughter, Miriam, and her husband, Aaron. Next is my son, Mati, our son, Mati, and our daughter-in-law, Yehudis. And then our son, Hank, and his wife, Esther. Henry.
Thank you. Mr. Topas, who are these people at whose wedding?
This is my daughter's wedding. They are my sons, my daughter, our daughter-in-laws, and the grandchildren.
Are these all your grandchildren?
Probably not. Some were born afterwards. Like my, for instance, my daughter's son was born. This was taken in 1993, and a child was born last December. So he's not in this picture.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Topas, there's a very nice young man sitting next to you. Can you please introduce him and tell us who he is?
This is my youngest son. His name is Ruel Gamliel, and he is an attorney in Jackson with a law firm associated with several associates. And he happens to be here, and that is the advantage. The others are not.
Your father was very eloquent and gave a message for future generations. Perhaps you have something to say to the younger generations of today?
It happens to be that I came in toward the end of my father's remarks and was listening from the other room. And I have to say I am my father's son, and I wholeheartedly agree with much of the message that he said. It would be difficult for me to say it better than he did. But I think that the unique thing is that the way I have experienced the retelling of the Holocaust story through being my father's son has had a tremendously deep impact on me and made me realize that the message is that there is a sacred duty for Jewish people to know about the Holocaust, to understand its messages, and to try to apply them to present problems, to realize that we need to be the ultimate realists in the world and not to be deluded by the thinking that led to tragedies in the past. That's the best message, I think, that we can take from it. So, I hope that maybe I've sort of just said that he left the impression on me that I feel as strongly. He has made a point of making his life about letting people know through his book, through lecturing, you know, through speaking about it to us when we were children. It would be accurate for me to say that I might have some mixed feelings about having known as much as I did about it as I was growing up, because it made me feel very different from other kids. We knew we were special. There was sort of almost a specialness about it that somehow felt like we were even a little superior to the other kids because of this connection. And I don't mean that I took it to heart, but it made us feel, well, our parents were survivors. That attaches a special significance. Somehow they were part of a group that was had a special destiny. And that was a flavor that it had. But I don't know how good that was to be a six-year-old or an eight-year-old, knowing that much about being an other, this other person in society that is distinguished by the survivor category.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. I do appreciate your adding to your father's comments. Thank you both.
Thank you.